Okay, I'll try and speak loud and clear. It's being live streamed for those of you who are at home. Welcome. Good morning to you all. My name is Aarti. I'm one of the co-chairs for the high school, like not co-chair, yeah. So, for the PTA. We will start off this coffee morning by introducing one of the strong big people in the PTA. Very approachable. When I say strong, doesn't mean that she's going to like shove you when you come to her. So, strong because it's a huge responsibility. Strong because she's fabulous to work with and she's a great leader. So I'd like to introduce to you Meena Bregman, the PTA president.
Thank you so much. And what Ari doesn't say is that she's been here 19 years. This is her last year. And she's been president or vice president and every single thing you can think of on this campus. So. And don't be fooled by her smile. She works so hard every day. She does a lot. But yes, I'm Meena Bregman. I do not have high schoolers yet. So I just like to come and peek up here. I'll have a high schooler next year. I'm not ready for it. But we've been here for 6 years. This is started of our seventh school year. And I'm serving as your PTA president for a second and a half year. But I've been on the board for about 5 years now. We are a big school. We have over 4,045, if I'm correct. And therefore, we really try to make sure that we, the PTA, we're here to build community, but we try to supplement what the wonderful administration and faculty do by continuing to try to build community in the way that each division needs. So in the elementary school, that means we have elementary reps that work, and I see one of our very long-term elementary reps there. Class parties, fun things like that. In the middle school, as they become more independent, we move away, we just support where the faculty and the administration tell us to support. In high school, as Artie said, she and Debbie are the high school reps, and they work mostly with the service club kids to ensure that they have a way and an avenue to earn money for their service clubs over the year, mostly through our barbecue and our international fair. So if you have any high school questions, they are the people you want to see. And obviously, they put on these wonderful monthly high school coffees for you, which is in conjunction with Darren Farney's office. So very topical subjects, and I think always well attended because I don't think high school parents get too much access to their kids, so they always show up for these coffees, which is wonderful. I've already highlighted this to a few of you because you came before for the welcome new family reception, but I just want to remind you that our barbecue, which is co-sponsored by Boosters, is this Saturday. We're almost ready. It's completely free. Boosters will be grilling their burgers. The American Club will be providing other food, and it's just really, really fun. In terms of high school, we have 16 service clubs participating already in this barbecue. It's the kickoff of the football season. We have dance performances by high school and middle school dance clubs. So it's a fun time. It's great to see the faculty and the kids out there. So please do put that on your calendar, 4 to 8 on Saturday. And again, we also co-sponsor the American Association Living in Singapore talk. It's coming up on September the 19th. And then if you're new, we also have the carpet auction. So just keep an eye out for that. I'm sure you've heard this from many people, but it's all in e-news. If you read e-news, scroll down to PTA, scroll down to Boosters, then you will see everything that you want to know there. And please do come to these events and get involved. We put them on for you. I hope you and your families have a great year, and I look forward to seeing you at the next high school coffee party.
Thank you. Thank you. The PTA at SAS is for the entire school, starting from ECC up until grade 12. So we work across all divisions. But the high school is blessed in a way that they have another exclusive organization which works solely for the high school at SAS, and that's the Booster Club. So I'd like to introduce the dynamic Sherry.
Thank you, Archie. The dynamic makes me Thank you all for coming to this wonderful PTA-sponsored coffee, and thank you, Archie and Debbie, for putting it on. We appreciate it so much. In the high school, we really love to have the parents come and join us. We have in Booster Club many different opportunities from barbecue to design and hospitality at IASIS events. There are so many opportunities for you to get involved. Come join us. On Wednesday, we'll have a coffee in this very room. It's a coffee and a volunteer fair. So all of the committees that are in Booster Club will be here with sign-up sheets, and we would love for you to come pick what you would like to do. Do 1 to 10, it's okay. Join us, we'd love to have you.
We just want to have a little bit more information. Actually, this is exclusively for the senior parents, the 12th graders. So if there are junior parents who want to help, could they help? if they want to. And it's mainly for the senior parents. It's mainly for the senior parents. So the rest of you can just pick up your sandwich or coffee. We have a lot of snacks outside. It's usually not this glamorous. This is our marketing event. So we just have it for the first time, and then it'll just be coffee and bagels. So I'd like to invite Calvin Edge to talk to you about this senior appreciation dates.
Yeah. My name is Carolyn Edge. I have a high school senior like many of you. I also have kids that have graduated from SAS, and I have a sixth grader. So I'm going to be 107 when I'm an empty nester. I'm here today just to represent this Senior Spirit Committee. It is a group of parents, primarily moms, so it's not limited to women only. If there are dads that want to get involved, that's fantastic. We're just a group of parents that are organizing events for our high school seniors. It is open to any parent that wants to contribute. We have we're on Facebook. There are links to sign up in the Sign Up Genius. We've asked that everybody just sign up for one event ahead of the event. There's been some confusion. So if over the last several months you see that somebody has been listed more than once, we've gone through to really make it equitable so that all parents can get involved. If spots are filled to be the coordinator, there are plenty of spots available to be a contributor. There are suggestions for what these topics might be. We are not married to those topics. So if you see that there is availability to host something, I don't even know what month is still, whatever. Let's say March is free and we have a couple of suggestions. If you don't like what those suggestions are and you want to be a leader, then come up with your own idea. But these are events that are it's nice to see that there is some tradition coming in for high school seniors. This started a few years ago, but we're really organized now. We are asking that if you would like to contribute $25, if you want to give more, you can give more. If you want to give less, you can give less. But the money that we collect goes to put these events on for our seniors. Ice cream, candy, donuts, hot chocolate. It's endless. If you have any questions, you can contact me after the coffee. You can speak with Sherry. We'd be happy to answer your questions, but I do really want to stress that it is open for everyone to be involved. This is not a group of six moms who are trying to run the whole show. So thank you. Here's the donation box. It'll be in the back of the room.
Thanks.
Thank you
so much, Carolyn. So for those of you who are watching from home, you can PayLah me if you'd like to contribute. My phone number for the senior appreciation days. The box will be at the back. So if you are not carrying cash, drop your credit card. So if you're not carrying cash, please feel free to drop it off at the high school office. Just mention senior appreciation days, and then you can drop it off at the high school office whenever you're here, or your child can drop it off at the office. Thank you so much. And it's a great thing seniors enjoy. They feel privileged anyway being a senior wearing the red hoodies. And it's nice to just pep them up a little before the applications and all, and right through the whole year, the senior semester also. Okay. I'd like to introduce Devi Faryal. She is my co-chair for this year. A lot of you know Devi, have worked with her. Great work ethic. She's been the international fair chair, done it very, very, very successfully many, many years. She's been on the board. Then she is a bit senile, so she decided to co-chair with me. So she's going to be talking to you first. Devi.
Thank you. I love Arti so much. That's why I take this job. My name is Devi. This is our fifth year in SAS. I have a junior, only one child. And what Mina has mentioned, as a PTA high school rep, our job is to work along with the booster club and then to work with the students, especially the high school clubs. We give them the opportunity how to raise funds through our events, and then also working with the admin teams. Just to highlight our big events of the year, the first one, the upcoming welcome barbecue, and then the second one, international fair. I've been the chair for the past 3 years. So I would say the international fair is the PTA biggest the fundraising event. I mean, it's a huge event. It'll be this year, next year, I think it'll be in March 16th. It used to be February, the end of February, but March 16th. So it's a fun day. We have so many different food from different countries. At least we have about like 14, 15, you know, like country booth participating and then selling food. And then the third one will be the staff appreciation. Should I tell them the theme? Last year we had the theme was the Hollywood, and it was a big success. And this year, because it's artists, last year in SAS, so it's to honor her, the theme will be,
what is it?
Incredible Bollywood. And the last one will be the staff appreciation will be in April. The last one will be the graduation. It will be in May. So yeah, we'll need a lot of volunteers. So this is one way how to participate and to volunteer. So we'll have the sign up
sheets.
The sign up, and then so you can sign up. Okay. So yeah, you can always contact us through email. Our email is sastpa.hsrep@gmail.com. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Devi. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Aarti Neelakantan. This is my 18th year and my last year at SAS. Life after. I have been a PTA volunteer, like many others in the room, for multiple years. I'm almost 16 or 16 and a half out of the 18 years that I've been here. I've enjoyed every single year, which is why I'm coming back. It's not just by habit, it's just that I love being here. So as a parent at SAS, you are part of the PTA. So you are a PTA member any which ways. So all what you need to do is just call or email and sign up to do a little bit more than just being a PTA member, is just to be a volunteer. It's extremely fulfilling, more so in high school. Like I mentioned a little before, this is the only way you'll get to see your kids moving, acting, talking, at least to check if their teeth is okay, because they don't open the mouth in front of you, at least mine. So it's a great way to get involved. If you really want to keep an eye on them, I guess Booster Booth, sign up as a sub. They're so full up, it's like I'll probably get my VR application done faster than they can get a sub. At the Booster Booth, it's heavily favored by a lot of high school parents. Having said that, the PTA is also visible. I mean, we don't have a booth, but we float around the whole place, so everywhere, and just act big, and we do a little bit of work also now and then. So it's been wonderful. So I'd really encourage all of you to just sign up for something at the high school, whether it's PTA, whether it's boosters, as long as you're keeping in touch with what's happening with your child's life. So it's a great opportunity. Having said that, the volunteer opportunities with the PTA is limited to a few events, because our main job is to lies with the students and the administration. What we do, she talked about the activities, Debbie talked about all the activities that we do. What I'm going to tell you is a little bit more about the coffee mornings that we organize. This is with in coordination and with help from the high school admin team and Dr. Farney's office. We organize a coffee morning every month. So it is usually, unless it's closed on a particular Monday, it is usually the first Monday of every month. So the topics are seasonal and topical. So if little before prom, we will discuss prom, little before interim, we will discuss interim, and we will discuss ATs and APs right through. No, we don't. We try and keep ATs and APs to a couple of coffee mornings, otherwise nobody else gets a chance. So if you have any questions, it could be about the bus, it could be about ATs and APs also, it could be about sports, it could be about any activities. Please write in directly to the principal if you would like to, but if you would like it to be routed through us, then Devi and I are available. You can call. Don't call her, she travels a lot, so she'll have an ISD bill. So email us, so we can pass on the information. We are like those constantly whining to him, because anything that somebody comes and tells us that they're upset about or not happy with, 100%, whether he likes it or not, it is communicated to him. So that's what we do. The first half an hour, I cry and she cries, and then we talk about the nice stuff. So it's very easy. He's very accessible. His office is very accessible. But if you still feel more comfortable talking to us or emailing us, please do that. The coffee morning topics are based on the questions and the feedback that we get, whether it's a verbal thing, it could be over coffee, it won't be at the gym because I never go there, so it could be at the club, it could be anywhere. So you, as if you say that this is something which is concerning you and you would like this to be discussed at the coffee morning, we will organize for that. What happens is if you have, if five or six people have a concern, then we will call the person administrator or the faculty in charge to organize a breakout session. But if it is just you and your child who's having a problem, then we will send you to PAC. So that's our conversation. But rest assured that every single issue that you have will be addressed. We will try to address it. So if there are anything, just email us or write to us. Otherwise, the coffee mornings go every first Monday of every month, and we do discuss what's coming up. So right now, it's the back to the welcome barbecue, PTA and boosters welcome barbecue. Somebody was confused that it's only for high school. It is not. It is mainly for the entire school. Just so the high school parents, if you want to see your kids work, I just mentioned a little before, if you want to see them actually pick up plates and dump them and clear up and clean up, so this is the time to come. This is the time to see, because we have about 16 plus 2, 18 clubs which work there. Many of your kids are involved with the service clubs, activity clubs, and general clubs. So we coordinate with all of them and we give them an opportunity to raise funds. So they are very responsible. They are very reactive to us. They talk to us. They get upset with us, they're happy with us also. So love doing this job. The sign-up sheets is going to be right at the back. I won't take up too much of your time. But please sign up. We will have an additional sheet now that I see happy faces. Sign up for bringing in snacks for the coffee morning. So if you're tempted by what we have, you could make us happier next month. So you could sign up to bring in some snacks. Otherwise, we will have coffee and bagels every month. So thank you so much for coming. And now, the best part of the coffee morning, Dr. Farney.
It's good to have you all back again this year. I certainly look forward to these parent coffees and really kind of hearing what's out in the community and communicating and working together on things. You know, it's SAS in my eighth year international, and it's amazing how time flies. And I have a daughter who's in eighth grade and a daughter who's in sixth grade, and it's amazing how quickly they become international kids, not U.S. kids. That's where we're from originally. When it really hit was I was sitting watching TV with my daughter, eighth grade daughter Pearl, and we're watching my parents DVR'd American TV shows back in the States, right? And we're laughing and having a great time, and we're watching commercials and all of that. And my daughter Pearl turns to me and goes, "Hey, Dad, do we pay extra for the commercials?" Yes, we have definitely been overseas a while, right? So anyway, it happens quickly. These particular coffees, I work with Debbie and Artie to really lay out what the community is interested in hearing and what the community needs. So when she says, please reach out to her, please do that. The things that you bring to her, she brings to me, and Debbie and Artie bring to me. We do process that. You can also give compliments and positive feedback, not just your concerns, and we'll process that too. When we talk coffee, Artie and Debbie were really looking for putting names to faces as the objective. How do we let new folks and returning folks know about the programs that are happening here and start to put people's names to faces on who are running those programs? And so that is the goal today. And then at the end, we'll do some question and answer and kind of what's trending at SAS. So I'm just going to go through a list of folks. Everybody from Sue Nesbitt, our PAC counselors, to our PAC counseling program, to department chairs as well, because sometimes you don't get to see who our department chairs are. And so when I call them up, I'm just gonna ask them to tell you a little bit about themselves, the program they run, and that's about it. So we'll move through them fairly quickly. So to start, is Sue
in?
Just stepped out. Maybe what we'll do is start with our representative from college counseling to talk, introduce himself and talk a little bit about our college counseling program, Mr. Trevor Sturgeon.
Hi, everyone. This is my 10th year at SAS.
You want to come up so they don't have to, the chiropractors love that, actually. But.
Hi there, this is my 10th year at SAS. As many of you know, I have two kids. I have a daughter who's a junior, and my son's in eighth grade. I know that college is always a big topic in high school. Over the last year, we developed our programs. One new thing, which many of you know, is we're having monthly parent coffees, where basically there are chances for parents to sit down with a counselor, a couple counselors, and actually have an informal sort of chat. I think you've all received a whole list of our programming this year. There's seven of us over there. Your kids do get a counselor at the end of 10th grade, sorry. And that counselor stays with them for the college piece throughout the rest of high school.
Perfect. All right. Thank you. It's important, I think, to mention, and also before we introduce our Dean of Student Life, Ms. Sue Nesbitt, we went through a long renewal process with our counseling program. We used to have a combined counseling model where your son or daughter's college counselor was also their personal and academic counselor. And through a long process, we looked at all over the United States and best practice, we decided to make a split, and we added additional counselors, because we know that the college counseling side of the game is getting more complex in college admissions. And so we have seven college counselors now to give more attention to that. But we also know this is stressful. And you see it in your kids, that this is a stressful process. So we also bolstered our personal and academic counseling side of the house. And to talk a little bit about that and student life at SAS is our Dean of Student Life, Sue Nesbitt.
Hi, welcome. Nice to see some familiar faces and some new ones. Yes, we have five personal academic counselors over in beautiful Student Life Center, a space that's deliberately being created to feel less stressful than, say, the rest of the school. So please come over and take a look at that space, a small caseload of about 60 students as well. And we have a high school psychologist who's housed in the Student Life Center. Now, we see our students through grade 9 to grade 12, so they're with us all those 4 years, and then they meet their college counselor at the end of grade 10. We are very active. Every day we're busy doing programming for our students, so we have met with all of our grade 9s in large group seminars, small groups, and also at the individual level. We're starting with our grade 10s, 11s, and 12. We started last week, where we're pulling them into our office, doing small group meetings, checking in on them, seeing how they're doing. We also have parent programming. So this past month, we did a nuts and bolts, all of the counselors, the PAT counselor did nuts and bolts for all new parents, grade nines, new parents to the high school. And then Jeff did a boot camp starting last week. That's Dr. Jeff Devins, one of our PAT counselors, and he's continuing this week. Towards the end of the month, we have Chris O'Chanassy, who is a guest speaker, talking to all of the grade nines on transition, change management. And he's also doing a session with the seniors, dealing with college and transition. On the 24th of September, we'll be offering a parent presentation for you, which will be on the topic of change management, grade 9 to grade 12. And then we have teams and technology for parents in October. So every month we are offering something for the parents, tying it to what we're also doing in seminars so you can have some common conversations at home. So any questions, concerns, compliments, always welcome. Student Life Center, happy to see you. Thanks.
Thank you, sir. As you can see, with college PAC counselors going with your students for the 4 years, we're trying to give you opportunities to say, okay, who is that person I call if I'm not sure? So if you're new to SAS or new to ninth grade here, go ahead and pick up the phone, call that PAC counselor, introduce yourself, and ask the question. It's okay, and same goes with administration as well. Please don't hesitate to pick up the phone and give a call. Next up in the lineup is Dr. Dennis Steigerwald, who is our Center of Innovation Coordinator, to talk a little bit about our programs there.
Thank you. So my name is Dennis Steigerwald, and this is my 20th year. Some of you may recognize the name because my wife is also head of counseling for elementary school. We have two sons. My youngest is Grant, he's in seventh grade, and my oldest is now. And so just before the beginning of the year, we were having dinner, and I was like, I am so excited to see you day in and day out at school. He didn't return the same season. So it's been fun, but I will tell you, it's also been a learning journey for me and Colleen through this. So often the question is asked, where is the Center of Innovation? And in reality, it's a platform that sits under the entire high school. We want to support everyone in exploring what they're interested in, pursuing passions in new and flexible ways. And so some of the main services and programs we support within our area, if you go down to the library area, you'll see Bob Helmer. He's our teacher librarian, library services, research, and he teaches the AT seminar course. We have Mr. Dan Skimmon, who is the director of Interim, and Nora, you'll find her in there. She does amazing things on all these programs, but she also really supports Interim. Matt Hughes is there, and he's our PLC lead for Catalyst. You can see him, or you can also see me. I've taught it, and I help support that also, as well as Stacy Jensen, who helps lead the advisory program here. If you go over kind of to the other side, you'll see my office, and I can help with advanced studies. So that's AP with AP exam registration, AT and Syracuse University registration. On our first floor, you'll see we have a makerspace, we have the Catalyst Commons, we have emerging tech, and we also have Brandon Walthall, who is our supervised study learning lab specialist and kid relationship extraordinaire. He's amazing at just truly touching kids, their heart as well as their mind. And so that's kind of a services and the programs we support. And if you have questions, me or anybody in that area and on the team, thanks.
All right, thank you. So the next part, we're gonna try something new. When Debbie and Artie and I talked about maybe bringing some departments and just say a little about themselves and their department and maybe how to support as extra support. We just kind of did it by chance to see who had off during this period, because many of them are actually in classrooms teaching your students. It looks like the lucky ones that actually had off are here. If you want to maybe come up and we'll just do a quick introduction, so that would be great.
Steve, I'll stay back here.
Oh, okay. All right. Quick interview.
Hi, everybody. My name is Jason Atkinson, and I've been here for 13 years now. I have three children and still in the elementary school. Envious of you, Dennis, getting there. My role here is as an instructional coach, but I've served as a teacher of Catalyst and a teacher of AP Capstone program, as well as a history teacher. And now my role is as the tech DC, and tech is technology. So of course, like AP Computer Sciences, the E is the elective. So all these menu courses that you might see, graphic design, for example, and then C is Capstone. And that's not only AP Capstone, but that's also Catalyst, as Dennis just mentioned. So that's my role as supporting these teams. And if you have any questions, you also have me. Thanks.
Hi, I'm Brenda Baisley, and I'm the department chair of the English department. This is my fourth year here at SAS. I have two kids, one in fourth grade, one in second grade. And my husband is one of the deputy principals in the middle school, Chris Weingessner. With the English department, it is the only subject that students are required to take every single semester of high school. And
yeah.
That's exactly how the students feel too. And as such, we try and maintain a wide variety of options for students so that they can customize the courses that they take. And whether that's through our humanity classes in grade 9 and 10 or the straight English classes, and then in their junior and senior years, there are a number of options, semester-long option courses, as well as our AT and AP options, which continue to evolve. So currently I teach World Studies 9 and Advanced Placement English Language and Composition, but I've also taught English 9, English 10, and a number of different menu courses. So I sort of dip my toes everywhere. So if you have any questions about any of those options, I'm definitely happy to speak to you about them.
Hi, my name is Emily Leopold, and I am the current head of department for the math department. I replaced Lance Murgatroyd, who did it for 5 years. Unlike English, you don't have to take math 4 years, but we often have students who take four and plus, which is awesome. I have four children. Two are in high school right now, grade 9 and grade 11, and then I have two in the middle school. This is my 9th year here, and I have taught almost all the subjects, and currently I'm teaching pre-calculus, which I know is one of the most challenging courses, they say, has a reputation, and I've also taught geometry for many years. So if you have questions, if your child needs help in math, they should first seek out help from their teacher. We offer, I mean, if you come down the hallway of math teachers, you will see us helping students all the time, whether it's during break, during lunch, after school, during our free periods. We are pretty active, and we want them to come see us and get help. And we try to advertise to you at back to school night, we advertise to our students, that we prefer them to come to us before they seek a tutor if they can. So please, we want to help them, have them come see us first. And if you need to get a tutor outside of that, that's fine. There's also peer tutors. So some students like to work with another student during the day. So there's an organization that gets peer tutors together. When they get that together, we advertise that in our classes as well. So just to make sure you know, we want to help your children as much as we can. So please send them to us if they feel like they're struggling or they're not sure, or just give us an email and let us know. Thanks. And then Steve, do you want to take
this? I'll stay back here and do a comment for that. My name is Steve Mudd. He's our Zen boy. I have a daughter who's a senior at University of St. Thomas. We have a sophomore and a senior here. So we've got two graduations to attend this spring. Which is really interesting. And actually, my daughter's graduating the day after our concert here on the 25th, so I'm still working out how I'm going to get home. Anyway, I'm part of the Visual Performing Arts Department and the AV team, and lots of fascinating things for you to come see throughout the year. We have advertising on e-news, so the best way you can support us is to come and see our amazing shows. We're doing a high school musical in mid-October this year, so we're full on. We start auditioning every first day. So anyway, whether it's AP art exhibitions or some of our shows, please come and see our amazing kids. Yeah.
All right. Thank you. Thanks, DCs. I know you have things going, so if you'd like to excuse yourselves. I think the crux of why we wanted to start getting DCs or department chairs in front of you is what you heard Ms. Leopold saying. We want to help your kids. We don't want the first choice to be, I have to go get a tutor. And sometimes I think that floats in our community. That is not true. Our teachers want to support your kids. You need to have them reach out or connect. It's part of the ethos of what we do as a professional learning community-based school. And I'll talk a little bit about that later. But at the heart of it, we want to help students. And so when struggle, there is no better person to actually help them be successful in the class than the teacher teaching the class. And so we want to continue to encourage that this year. And I know that's something that Debbie and RT and I talked about, and how do we reinforce that message that we want to support and we want to help. Before I move on, I want to introduce my high school admin dream team, Mr. Lee and Ms. Zubermahan. So if you'd like to come on up and do a quick intro.
Hi, good morning, everybody. I think I know a lot of you in the audience at this point, but for those of you I don't know, my name is Stephen Lee, and it is my pleasure and my honor to be serving at the beginning of my 4th year at SAS. Just a little bit about myself. I hail from the Boston area. I am the only son of Vietnamese refugees, and so I was the first generation of my family to be born in the States. So oftentimes I'll say, when people ask me where I'm from, I'll say, well, I'm 50% Chinese, 50% Vietnamese, and 100% American. So that's a little bit about my identity. I'm also the very, very proud father of two little eagles who are at the Early Learning Center. And it has been amazing to see them grow and also to better understand our community through their eyes and through being a father here. In terms of what I do and how I hope you'll reach out, first of all, if you ever have any questions about any of our programs, academic or social-emotional, please feel free to contact me. I have the privilege of working directly with several of our department chairs. So I work with both counseling departments, the English department, our tech department, as well as our world languages department. So that's sort of where my expertise lies. But I also do direct support for 11th grade families and students, as well as 12th grade families and students. So just so we can get a sense, can you raise your hand if you have an 11th grader or a 12th grader here at SAS? Okay, fantastic. Well, I hope that you won't hesitate, any of you really, but especially those of you with your hands up, to come and see me if ever you have a question. And having said that, I'll hand things over to my counterpart, Ms. Amber Zubermihan.
Good morning. My name is Amy Zubermihan. Kids often call me Mrs. ZM if they're Canadian like me, or Mrs. ZM. Zubermihan can be a bit trippy. I am beginning my 14th year here at SAS, which means I've now been in Singapore for almost half of my life. I'm beginning my 14th year. I've got two children. I have a fourth grader, George, and Stella is in first grade. She's in the Chinese immersion program, which is such a gift that Stella gets to be a part of that. I have the honor to and privilege to work with our grade 9 and 10 students. How many of you have freshmen who are just entering those first weeks? Welcome. I'll echo what Stefan said. At any point in time, it can, you know, high school and a transition to high school, it can be overwhelming at times. Our offices are open. My office is open to you. You've met a lot of people today. If you don't know who your point person to go to is, you don't remember who the PAC counselor is, the department chairs, please pick up the phone, give me a call, drop me an email. I'm happy to send you to the right direction, or come in and have a chat with me as well. I'm also this year the proud advisor of an Andor advisory. They're seniors this year, so I get to dabble in that senior. I see some of my senior advisory parents in the crowd today. That's another resource that we have to help students navigate the high school. So please reach out to those advisors as well. So welcome. Thank you for being here this morning, and we look forward to our year with you.
So we've heard about others. Now, for those of you who are new to SAS, a little bit about me, or maybe you just have never really heard my story. I was the son of a military officer in the Air Force. My father did 23 years in the U.S. Air Force. So we moved around, and he was a linguist and then worked in nuclear missiles and ultimately ended up at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. One day I remember, and I didn't really think much of that life. That just was my life growing up. And I remember one day coming home from college, and my new college roommate came home with me, and we walked into my parents' living room. And he looked, and he was staring at something. I'm like, what's going on, Randy? He goes, hey, Darren, I think you're probably the only house on the block that's got a picture of a nuclear missile hanging on the wall in your living room. And we did, and I think he was right. But anyway, I went on then to college to study biology in Wisconsin. And it was there I had choices to make. Certainly, I had to choose, I guess my choices were really that I was thinking about were dentistry, chiropractic, or education. And I decided to go work at a summer camp for inner city kids from Milwaukee, and they were kids with gang affiliations and these types of things. I went to that place, one person, and I came out another person. It absolutely clarified for me that that's what I wanted to do the rest of my life, was work with kids. And so from that, I went on and got my first job teaching biology. And then I taught everything from at-risk kids in biology to advanced placement biology and anatomy and physiology and just about everything in between. And then moved into administration, where I held roles back in Wisconsin as a gifted and talented coordinator, an assistant principal, and then also finally a principal at a school of about 1,300 in the suburbs of Milwaukee, Wisconsin, or outside of Milwaukee. We then came to Singapore 8 years ago, where I was an assistant principal, and I learned so much about international education and cultural competence and all of these things that very much I wasn't exposed to in Wisconsin. Then was also served as the support services coordinator, K-12 here at SAS, while I was assistant principal. And then finally, 5 years ago, moved into the principal role. About me and my philosophical underpinnings, I mean, you've heard the the gang affiliate, that's near and dear to my heart about how do we make sure every kid gets a fair chance at those things that will help them be successful. My doctoral work was in literacy and high school literacy and students who are struggling or multiple years behind in their reading. And I worked on this, I guess at that time it was new, a philosophy called response to intervention. In other words, how do we systematically intervene to help support students who are struggling? And so that also carries with me. I wrapped up that work of just the research part of it before coming overseas and then wrote my doctoral dissertation when I was here. That fueled deeply into what we call professional learning communities for me and my belief in professional learning communities. Some of you have heard of this before, others it's brand new, but what I need you to know, and I think it's important that we get a refresher and we should start talking about this more, is behind the scenes, what your kids, what their teachers are doing on those Wednesday and Friday mornings are collaborating on four key questions. What do we want kids to know and be able to do? Know it. So the first one's curriculum. What is the curriculum? Let's unpack it together so we're consistent with that. The second part is how do we know when they know it? That's the assessment part. And in other words, are we giving good aligned assessment to that curriculum? The third question is, what do we do when kids don't know it? And that's the intervention piece, to say, okay, now we have that information on the assessment. What are we as the teachers going to do to help get that kid caught up? And the fourth question is, what do we do when a kid already knows it? We don't want kids sitting bored in the third row because they're like, oh my goodness, I've heard this before. That's what's happening on Wednesday and Fridays. Your kids' teachers are getting together to collaborate in their professional learning community teams to answer those questions. Along with that is a mindset. It's a growth mindset about your kids. Several years ago, we did a K-12 book study about the book mindset. Great read, and it's not education speak. It's by an author by the name of Carol Dweck. And it just, in essence, says, if the future's untold on what a kid can do. If you have a fixed mindset about what a kid can do, you will only get so much. If you have a growth mindset about what a kid can do, the sky's the limit. It's untold. And so that's very much the approach we take at SAS in working with our students, that indeed the future is not written. That we should expect high levels of learning from all kids, not just the ones we think might be able to get it, but we expect all kids can get it. And we expect those high levels of learning. And what the research plays out is when teachers believe in the kids, then the kids start believing in themselves, and that leads to higher learning. So that's very much an important part of SAS. Another part of that is collective responsibility. We are collectively responsible as the teachers and administrators in this building for your students' learning. And that's why when Ms. Leopold gets up and talks about, hey, we want you to send your kids to us if they don't understand, that's part of collective responsibility. That is our responsibility if your kid doesn't get it. That's been an evolving thing in the sense that I don't know that that was the case 8 years ago here or that everyone necessarily believed it, but that's certainly the case now. Our teachers want to help your students. It's our response. It's our responsibility. So because of this work, we were the first school internationally to get all things PLC, exemplary PLC school status, and we've had that 4 years in a row. We are not perfect. We are a large system. We're not perfect, but we continue to work on that. So I just wanted to talk a little bit about that as Debbie and Artie and I try to get information to you about how do we support your kids when they're struggling. But there is this whole support network that we've put together behind the scenes for your sons and daughters. Okay, enough of that. I usually do, at the end of these things, kind of a what's trending. And I know there's a couple things trending and I want to speak to them. And then at the end of this, you'll have some time to ask questions and this type of thing. But one thing, yeah.
Sure.
Okay. One thing that is trending right now is graduation. I know some of you did the surprise calendar walk, like, okay, the first day of school, you're saying, when's this thing over? And you turn to the back and you found graduation was actually earlier than it's traditionally been. And I did put something out to e-news, but I think it's important you hear it here as well in case maybe that didn't get out. When we looked at where graduation, we go to a theater called the Star Theater. It's a beautiful venue. It's absolutely fantastic. Unfortunately, where our graduation fell next to the Hari Raya Puja holiday. And because we need 2 days, setup and rehearsal day, and the actual graduation day, it fell on Hari Raya, and they said you have to do multiple days. It's an extremely expensive venue, and there's also some structural things with the holiday that there were struggles with. So when we looked at it, we decided we wanted to keep that venue for our seniors, and that meant we had to move it back. So it's the Friday before final exams. I want you to know that, or for the whole school, those final exams, seniors, we met with department chairs again. They have committed that indeed there will be a culminating final experience for seniors. It may be an exam or some other experience, and it will be metered out such that we understand your kids, that's a busy time for them, so it needs to be appropriate for the time frame they have. And so I just wanted to put it out there again. This was not something that we just chose to do. It's something that was happenstance with the venue. I believe it will be ultimately low impact to the learning for kids. But at the end of the day, seniors get to keep that venue. And the feedback we've had from seniors is they love being done on that Friday. And it might actually work better for families. So we'll see how that plays out. The other thing that's been trending is bags and tables in the cafeteria. And I just want to let you know that we have been working on that. What had happened is on the first day when kids set their bags down and find seats and they end up, I don't know if it's like an evolutionary thing. They find a spot and they want to stick there. Maybe it's a safety thing. I'm not quite sure. But students finding spots. And what had happened on day one is kids settled into spots. What they didn't know is there was a table had been moved. That was one part of the story because of egress issues for safety from our facilities folks. And someone went in the morning and moved a table back into that spot. So folks settled in that spot. And then we had to say, I'm sorry, we have to move that. It's a safety issue. And so there were some hard feelings over that. The other thing that happened is there were multiple bags being left unattended in the cafeteria. What it says in the handbook and has said for many years is you cannot leave your things unattended, and it's for multiple reasons. Some of it's when you go to college and you leave your bag unattended, it goes away. That's part of it. Some of it is from time to time we will have a theft, and we typically find who the person is that steals something, but it takes a massive amount of time for us to track that down. And so it's just good practice for you to hold your $1,500 computer close and not leave it hanging around. But then there's another part of this. It's a safety issue. When we really started to take action on picking up bags because kids were leaving bags is when we found out some of the ELC kids have tripped trying to navigate through because that early learning center group uses the cafeteria space as well. And so as they tried to navigate through, we had a couple trips. There's also things about housekeeping and making sure that the space is clean. And if there's bags all over, the housekeepers can't get in there and clean it up. And the final thing is, if there's bags laying over, that's a common space. That's a common space that anyone should be able to use at any time. And if it's full of bags, that means that kids, families, whoever's visiting can't use that space. And so that's the reasoning. I think if we had the do-over button, I think we could have communicated that better to our kids from the start, and that might have got ahead of it. If you're wondering, well, where does my kid put their bag? There are bag facilities. We'll give them one locker, two lockers, five lockers. There are way more lockers than people actually use here. And so your son or daughter can just go to the high school office to Ms. Maz. She'll give them a locker. If the bag doesn't fit there, we have a locker room as well that's open during the day. We just put in push button locks so they can actually set their combo and put their material in there. Or if they have a really large bag, we've got a bag storage facility down in the training room next to Mr. Crane's and Ms. Vanderlinden's office and the athletics and activities office, so they can leave bags there. This thing isn't over. We're looking at kid feedback as well about what they want and what kind of setup they want, and so we're continuing to have that dialogue. But I think it's important that we don't take safety lightly, and you hear that. And it's also important that you know kind of the backstory on what's going on. I know these things can be frustrating for kids, but we try to work through it.
Yeah. And you just mentioned that for the students, the Center of Innovation is not that big bag storage area.
From Dr. Steigerwald, Center of Innovation is not the big bag storage place. Yes.
The rumor.
Yes. Hold those things close. So that's the inside scoop on that. Before
one word, just quickly.
Yes, please.
So I had said earlier to the group when I introduced myself that your feedback is important, and I always want you to feel like.
Thank you very much. Yeah, and I always want you to feel like my door is open, both when you have praise about things that are going well as when you have concerns and questions and suggestions. So I just wanted to say to this group, because there are members of the parent community in the room who came and spoke to me about sort of the impact that this was having on specific kids. And I just wanted to thank you for that. Thank you for doing that. It prompted self-reflection, as these things should. I think if I'm a leader in a community of learners, that I should be one of the best learners as well. So it was because of your feedback that I reflected on the situation. And you know what? I'm able to own it. And I think I was able to own it with our kids too, that I could have communicated this more proactively. I do believe in the rule because I want it to be a community space and I want it to be a safe space. But I could have done a better job of letting kids know so it wasn't an unpleasant surprise. And that part of that just came from your feedback. So thank you for that. That's all I wanted to say.
Thank you, Mr. Lee. At this point, there's a couple last announcements before we break into question time. So I'll turn it over to Archie.
Thank you, Dr. Fahmy. Just a couple of things that we missed. So I'm going to ask Mina to come back and talk to you about this fabulous space. How many of you know where the PTA office is actually? These are parents who also volunteer. So, yeah, she's going to talk to you about the PTA, the space that we have for all of us to use. So, and then I'll come back for one final.
Yeah, sorry. I should have mentioned this earlier. But yeah, I just wanted to highlight that over the summer, for those of you who are returning, you may have noticed that Boosters and PTA are no longer selling uniforms. It's been consolidated by the school. But over the summer, they were kind enough to allow us to have a big renovation in our PTA space, because we want to continue to be part of the community, we want to continue to be open, we want it to continue to be a place where people can gather. So I don't know if you've been there yet, but it is gorgeous, and we thank the school for that. And we are now serving Mr. Ho's Grab and Go there as well, but special recipes. Salads that you're not gonna find in the middle school cafeteria, because we've given him specific recipes from Carrot Sticks and Cravings in different places that we like. So we are now going to be open from 8:15 to about 4 o'clock every day, which means that for elementary parents who are hanging around for EAA pickups, they can have a space to go to. And if you're just on campus, stop by. We have breakfast down there now, lunch down there now. You know, Sherry's had lunch. I think the salads are pretty good. Yeah, it's a really nice space. And for all parents around school, you can book our PTA space. We have a meeting space in the back, and you can book that. If you're meeting parents for a coffee, school-related things, you can book that through our secretary. It's there for you. It's your community space. So please do come down and take a look. We're right next to the admin as you drive onto campus, the little round area. And we sell used books there all year round. We sell some sustainable products and some of the youth sizes from Boosters as well. So please do spread the word. Thank you, RT. Sorry, I forgot to mention that earlier.
Thank you, Nina. One announcement. Many of you are on Facebook. Many of you are as active as 15 times a day. So please sign up for the high school parents group. I am active, Jukko's nodding, yeah, I can watch it. So it's called SASPTA High School Parents Group. So this is, please let me reassure you, this is not an official page talk. The high school admin team has nothing to do with it. Having said that, we try and post official information, actually correct information. And it also has multiple events coming up. So we have a couple of days ahead of time. We just prompt Facebook, put up those events. So can't comment on every question. immediately, though I am online most of the time, but I need to get the information for you. So Debbie and I will try and answer as many questions as possible, but if it's something related with your child's grade, I'm sorry, we cannot answer that question. What we do is PTA, basically PTA events. So if you have questions about booster events or any other events from any other division, we will direct you. This is exclusively for high school parents. So which means when your child graduates from SAS, you graduate out of the group too. So we try and remove them because we don't want to bombard them with so much information, which is irrelevant to their lives. We have sign-up sheets, like I mentioned, to volunteer, as well as the contact information for Debbie and I, with our email and the Facebook page, which is mentioned there. Please sign up. And we have multiple requests which are pending there because we don't know which grade your child is in. There are some really enthusiastic second grade moms who really want to be on our group. It's a bit too early for that kind of heartache, so we have to refuse them. So if you have a second grader and a 12th grader, then you're on. So, but if you just have a second grader or a middle school kid, we would encourage you to stay calm and wait for it. So we don't actually have that information. So we have also, we also post, like most of you are aware that our coffee mornings are being live streamed. So having said that, it adds a lot of value for you to come here. One, because we can't take back all the sandwiches home. And the second thing is it's easier when we have a breakout session. Those things are not going to be telecast, right? So the breakout sessions which we will have depending on the topics, where smaller groups you meet with the administration, the leadership team, if you have any questions, those cannot be telecast. So only the main session is live streamed. The rest of it is off the camera. So if I would encourage everybody, I mean, I shouldn't be talking to this crowd, you guys are sweet and you've come here, for the rest of the parents, please do come in. It's wonderful to have a face-to-face interaction. But yes, of course, if you're not available, you're not free, you're traveling, or you're caught up in other work, every single coffee morning has been streamed live. And that will be available on, I think, almost for a little over a year, it's going to be available. You can go back and find answers to a few questions which you may have missed. So I encourage you to sign up for that. The Facebook page also has a link. The link cannot come 4 months ahead because we will get it only like 3 or 4 days before the coffee morning. So on the day of the coffee morning or a day before, you can actually go into the Facebook page and check out the link and click. You can subscribe where you can get notifications as and when the event's coming up. It'll say 4 hours to the wonderful coffee morning. So you can sign up for that too. Thank you very much for coming here. And now we'll have a very calm and peaceful Q&A.
Thank you. So just before we break out into Q&A session, I just wanted to say thank you to Sherry, RT, Debbie. We really are trying to focus on community this year. And we do have a statement of community about how we interact, and it's based on our core values of honesty, respect, responsibility, compassion, and fairness. And so I know the leaders in the parent organizations and the high school administration are very much committed to saying, how do we act as a community and how do we work together? Because we all want the same thing for our kids. We want them to be healthy and happy, and we want them to get a great education. So you'll hear more about as we progress through the year, but I think it's important we bring that up, that we are in this together and we're community working together. So at this point, here's how I think we'll do this to make sure people get the most questions answered that can be. And some of you are like, I've been sitting an hour and I just want to go. So here's how we're going to do this. I will be right up here. You can come up and ask questions. RT, can you stick around for a little while?
I can pass the mic.
Well, I'm wondering if we just break it up and do groups and have maybe Stefan take a corner, Amy will take a corner. I see Sue Nesbitt, our Dean of Student Life, back there. And so we'll just stay about. And I think what'll happen is the feedback from from RT last year was actually these breakout sessions work better because more people get more of their questions answered. And you can get it answered from the right person. And so I think we'll just do an informal breakout session.
Yeah,
yes.
Just before the breakout session, I think there are a few questions, a couple of them which I've got emails and messages. So the common questions, if you could just address at the full sure. audience, and then we could have breakout sessions.
Okay? Sure. Do you have any common questions?
I do have a few.
Absolutely. So like I said, we're going to start with some common questions, and then we'll do breakouts. These are things that I believe RT has been sent directly, and she's compiled the themes, and so we'll answer those for everyone.
I'm stressed out, so I don't need the mic. So it says, despite having a fantastic administration, faculty, huge courses, and a great set of teachers, some of the students are being compelled to use tuition centers to get good grades. Those B pluses and Bs and usually don't work in all of the colleges. So there is a tuition, and it's not verbatim, so I'm just reading the gist of it. Like a few parents were concerned that the students think it is a norm to, okay, Mike. Sorry. Yeah, this is a concern from a few parents. I have a few messages where the parents are concerned that it's becoming a trend that our students, SAS students, are going to outside tuition centers to get the extra help that they are not getting at school. So this is not 1, 2, or 10, 15 kids. The numbers I've heard is close to 400 to 500 kids.
Heard from who, RT? Just so
A couple of parents have said, may not be 400, 500, but yes, there are in the first couple of hundreds maybe who go to tuition centers. So that's a bit of a concern because this is a growing trend. It has not happened in many years past. It has not happened, but in the last few years, it's becoming like, so the new parents walk in and they say, oh my God, oh my child didn't get an A or an A plus. And they say, oh yeah, you can go to the tuition center. So it's becoming like a trend like other schools in Singapore are also having. So this is a concern. So they wanted it to be addressed. This is one there. The second one, I think a few of them have asked this question.
Do you want me to?
Yes, ma'am.
So this idea that your student needs to go to a tuition center to keep up or to get the grade runs absolutely contrary to an idea of a professional learning community school. This idea that we as the teachers and administrators are collectively responsible. We want to see your kids, and like Ms. Leopold said, we want them to reach out and connect. I can't dictate what you do with your money. I mean, if you decide, yes, I need to do that or want to do that, that's a personal family decision. But from the school's perspective, we have supports in place to help students when they're behind. All right. I want to kind of put a time slot on this in the sense that we have a lot of people in the room. So I would say maybe we go to quarter after and I can tackle some of these questions and then break out, because I know people have a lot of individual questions and you can go to various people in the room. So I think firsthand that, yes.
I said, I can't be super blind to all these tutors. It's because there's so much competition that if you do get a B plus, it's so frowned upon, and it's so and so they're going because they want the A's and the A pluses. When it is perfectly okay, I mean,
so
I think that it is as many families as Artie is saying. It really is that many people going to different outside tutoring who probably don't necessarily even need the outside tutoring. I did notice this year for 10th grade back to school, every teacher said, please come to us first. Every single teacher said that they were there during freeze, after school, and they want them to go first there because they know the material. So I do think, though, it's the competitiveness of our school in general, and it's a lot of the parents that are running this. And the kids, then, it trickles down to the children. So
yeah.
I do think.
So just for folks watching at home, the comment was that very much a belief that the competitive nature of this, that a B or B plus is not good enough, that an A plus is essential, really drives people to this extra help to get ahead. You know, I think there's a lot of family values wrapped up in these things as well. And when you have sit with your son or daughter and you decide on which courses they will take, you are also deciding how much stress they will have the following year. And you are also deciding how much support they're going to be needing if they take many, many advanced courses. So I think for the school, our job is to provide an advanced studies program that provides great options for kids. the family is going to have to sit down and have that discussion, a personal family values discussion about how much of that do we want to go after with our kids or let our kids pursue, and decide what's your right family balance.
One of the things I wanted to,
well, I agree with what Britt said, but the other thing that I think is a logistical thing also is a lot of the kids don't have the time in their schedules after school because they're either doing sports clubs, what have you, and it's impossible for those kids to go for that 1 hour time period that the teachers are making themselves available. It's not about that their teachers are not available, because they are. And I think that's great that when they have the time to access them, but there's a wide swath of things that kids do from 3:15 to 4 o'clock, where that, if that's the only time they have besides their 1 hour free, then they don't have the time during that time frame to get to them. So the only choice they have, if they need a little bit of extra help, is within a time schedule that works for their own time schedule. And that's a big, big part of some of the logistical reasons people have to maybe do other things, because the time schedules don't work.
So just for folks watching at home, the feedback was, it's not that necessarily teachers aren't trying to make themselves available, it's just kids are so involved in things during those times, it's a crisis of priorities in essence. They can't get to all the places they need to be. After school for 1 hour is indeed supposed to be protected time where kids have the ability to go. We don't start activities and athletics until after four, so kids can go see teachers during that time. But I get it, if you need help from three different teachers, that's a struggle. So that's good feedback. And
sorry,
I
heard from teachers said they open for all students from 7 a.m. to 6 p.m. Mm. So kids can go to teachers during the free period all the time. And in the morning when they go to school earlier with bus, like Tuesday, Thursday is booked for advisory, but the other days they have free time. So anytime kids can go to teachers and ask them, getting help from teachers, directly from the teachers is the best way. And there's many times available during the school time until 6 p.m. from 7 a.m.
Absolutely. Our teachers are very much available as much as they can. And one of the challenges that I think sometimes they face is they're teaching a course when the kid has a free. And so sometimes there's those types of conflicts. But yes, our teachers very much do try to make themselves available. Not typically till 6. I mean, it depends what our teachers have going on after school. But that's not the norm. Yeah.
Can I just comment on this quickly? Thank you.
All right, so I think the point that Tina brought up is a reality, which is, you know, how do I align the time that I have free as a student with the time that my teacher has free? And one thing that I've done pretty consistently as I work with families and students around this issue over the past several years is just remind folks that we take a PLC approach to supporting kids. And I think that that's something that's a bit unfamiliar. So Darren was mentioning earlier that we have collective responsibility for the success of your children. So in the past, and maybe we were used to this in high school, let's say Dennis is in Stefan's class. So the only person that Dennis would go to for help is Stefan, right? So now we're trying to change that paradigm and actually challenge that paradigm. So if Darren and I are both teachers of, let's say, Algebra 1, Dennis, in fact, can seek direct one-to-one help from either me or Darren. And I think that's one thing that we've been working with students around. Do not feel hesitant to reach out to another teacher of the same course who may have the same free as you, right? So a lot of times it's that free that really presents the opportunity to seek support. And if the student is reluctant for whatever reason, that's what we're here for. We can help kids to make that initial contact. The department chair can help them make that initial contact. Even their teacher can help them make that initial contact. So just want to make you as parents aware of that, that that's a big resource, not only your child's direct teacher, but everybody else in their PLC team.
Thank you. We've got about 2 more minutes for this particular one before we break up. So another.
I have just a really quick question about the calendar and how the impact of the graduation day moving forward impacts everybody else. I have a freshman and a senior. If I understand correctly, with graduation on the Friday, the final exams will still be on the Thursday and the Friday of that week, and then following the weekend, the Monday and the Tuesday. So then, do the seniors come back on Friday, the 7th of June, for school? Or like, how does that all work?
Yeah, that's a great question. So the question was, How does it work with graduation in the sense that if you have a freshman and a senior, do the seniors come back then after graduation? And how does it work for the freshman? And this is a great clarification point. For the senior, as soon as commencement happens, they are done. And they never have to come back to SAS, though oddly enough, they do, sometimes immediately after. I guess they couldn't quite get enough of a good thing. But yeah, once the senior's done, they are done. Unfortunately for their freshmen, for your freshmen, they need to continue on and take semester exams and stay till the end. It's a little bit of an odd year in the sense that we have that Hari Raya holiday there in that mix. But yes, the freshmen, sophomores, and juniors will go business as usual all the way till the end. Thank you.
So they'll be done at noon to attend the graduation.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely.
The walk is Thursday. Is the graduation
on Thursday? I don't have the calendar in front of me, but it's all stacked up that week right before graduation. One of the beauties of this is it's Senior Appreciation Day when they can go off together as a class. Then it's the graduation walk. Then it's the rehearsal luncheon together, and then it's graduation tighter this year. And so very much it is a nice celebration of our seniors.
So that all the seniors complete all their finals before that graduation ceremony, but everybody else has to do the before the weekend, after the weekend, and come back on the last day for that early dismissal day.
That's correct. That's correct. I'm so sorry. I know the vacation plans are spinning in your heads. I can see that. You're all doing your mental health, freshmen, sophomores, juniors, they do stay. So, question. Okay, we've got about 15 minutes and we do have a hard stop. I know our administration team has to move on to another thing, but we want to make sure we answer as many questions as possible. And so, what we're going to do is I'll break out over here. Maybe Mr. Lee, you take here. Ms. Zuber Meehan will be back there again. She's working with grades 9, 11, and 12. College counselors are wrapped up with things, but we can certainly answer some of those. Dr. Steigerwald as well will be over here. Please catch him with questions. And RT, where do you want to hang out?
I'm
got you. Hello. All right, thank you so much for coming, folks. We appreciate it.